Hey everybody, welcome to Rivalz Race Chat. Clinton and Adam here, as we are weekly, to talk about our favorite sport in the world, going in circles with our friends. How you doing today, Adam?
I'm all right, man. How are you?
Good, good. I really try and leave you alone from like midday Sunday, most of Monday. Touch base with you, make sure you're still alive on Tuesdays. Are you enjoying the C-free couple days I give you?
No, I'm not. It's weird. It's weird, man. For the world to be right, there's certain things I need in a given day. And sadly, talking to you is one of them. It's just a routine kind of thing. We might not even talk about anything good. Oddly enough, once in a while, we don't even argue about shit. But usually we do. But yeah, it's just part of the daily. So
yeah,
stop doing
that. People would be mad if we broke the kayfabe and actually let them know that we are really, we get along better when we're not on the air. But we do love to fight over a good battle when we got one. So today we're going to welcome Todd Lewis. Dylan Westbrook is going to join us, sprint car extraordinaire. Got a bunch of week and talk about a few other things too. Set up next week's show.
For sure. I had a good time Sunday. I was on Racetime Radio, Clint. I don't know if you knew that or not. But I was on with Joe. And he brought you up. We were talking about the dynamic with you and I. I said, the fun thing is, we've been arguing for 25 years, and it's not hard at all to bring up a topic because we will almost always be at, we're not always on exactly the same page. We're usually a little bit off. So it's been easy to argue with you for the better part of 25 years. It's just natural.
See, I thought on the whole Joe thing, but now if you we're talking about me, I'm gonna have to check. I missed Sunday's show, but that's good. I saw some comments. We need more Jim Irvine in our life. So,
absolutely.
By the way, before we bring Todd on, I owe Brian Nanico two Burger Barn meals already for a mistake here on the program. I'm not gonna point it out. And Brian, I just realized, I thought about it today, and I didn't get it fixed again, so I guess I'm going to have to take your whole clan out for dinner by the end of the week. Another dinner. Spencer, let me know if it's just my house lagging, or is everything lagging, because I'm falling a bit.
Yeah, I keep hearing you drop out there, Clint.
Try and mess with my network as soon as we can. So bring Todd on. I'll reach out. We will work it out if I drop out, and we'll be.
I think we should both drop out. Spencer, just bring Todd on and get rid of me and Clint.
Sure.
See what happens.
Sure. Bring me on. Just you guys take off. You know, leave me with a microphone and an hour to talk by myself. Yeah, that's I can fill it. No worries. Wherever you want to go, I'm fine with that. You guys want to bail? Whatever works for you.
If anyone can, Todd, it's you. I have ultimate faith that you are the man for that job. So how are things?
I've had stuff like that happen where you are expecting guests on shows and they don't show up and you figured that you had 20 minutes of Q&A to go with. And now it's like, okay, I guess I got to ask myself questions and talk back and forth. But I'm doing well. Thank you, Adam, for asking. So
you got to do St. Pete. So a few days of sniffing fumes and hearing race cars, that's got to really get the juices flowing, doesn't it?
It's been a great way to start the year, the last few years, getting to work at that event. It starts the day before the actual on-track activity because there's a kickoff luncheon and there's an event in the park that is near the racetrack where they do a 5K run for charity and they set up all the cars and it's a lot of fun. So all the teams come over, do a lot of driver interviews on stage and give away prizes. And then you get to the on-track stuff, which is fantastic. The USF Pro Championships and USF 2000, IMSA VP Racing Sports Car Challenge was there this year, and Indy Next and Indy Cars. And it's a lot of fun. It's a great 3-day event. It's right around spring break, depending on which week you're your school's let out. So it's good timing. There are lots of Canadians. In fact, they were telling me this, they reviewed the 23 event at the Firestone Grand Prix of St. Petersburg presented by RP Funding. They had visitors from every state in the union show up to that event in 2023. Wow. So that's all 50 states represented. And I can tell you that the crowds this year were even bigger. It is their best ever crowd, 20th anniversary. It was a sensational event.
Hold that thought, Spencer. I'm on the YouTube page and the show isn't loading. And I hear there's some people chatting saying, hey, the show is held up. So Todd just gave us like 120 seconds of pure gold. And I'm concerned that nobody is seeing it because it hasn't launched. So Todd, let's just have a conversation for a bit while we wait for things to get official.
All good.
How cool is it? So that's a Savory Green promotion, is it, St. Pete?
Green Savory Racing Promotions, yes. So they do, that's one of four IndyCar events that they promote on their schedule.
Did they take those because they're marquee events, or did they take those because they were events that needed someone to take them over and kind of let them live?
A little bit of both, maybe we could say. The St. Petersburg, they have always done, if you remember, it goes back to, it was Andretti Green Racing and Racing Promotions. It was a marketing company and it was a racing team. And then Michael Andretti wanted to focus strictly on the racing part of it. So he took what is now Andretti Global, IndyCar and Indy Next and all the other teams that he's involved with. And Kevin Savory joined Kim Green as partners and they have become racing promoters. They've known each other for, 30 or 40 years or something, but they have been in business together for better than 20 years now as part of racing promotion. So they do St. Petersburg. They own the Mid-Ohio Sports Car Course. They also promote the Honda Indy Toronto, which is now the Ontario Honda Dealers Toronto Indy, and the Portland IndyCar race they promote as well. All four of those are theirs.
Very cool. So, folks, welcome to Rivalz Race Chat. We apologize for the technical troubles. The first 4 minutes of the show were magical.
It's such a shame, isn't it, Adam? We'll never get it
back. We got rid of Clint. Clint was here. We kicked him to the curb. It was fabulous. But apologies. We're here, obviously, with Todd Lewis, a frequent flyer on the program and a frequent flyer in general. Todd, we talked about St. Petersburg. Let's put that behind us because most of our race fans, most of our viewers are all about what goes on here north of the border. What's next? Do you have to wait now until May, or do you have some filler between now and then?
I'm kind of like everybody else. It's sort of waiting. And I put up on Instagram and social channels today. I got the official email from NASCAR that my license or credential for the year has been approved. So it's like, I'm ready to go. I'm anxious. I'm eager to get started. So I know that there's a test day scheduled for May the 2nd, but I don't have any racing events booked prior to that. So it's, I'm a little bit eager to get going like you guys.
Yeah, it's a bit of a grind. Clinton, welcome back. We just reopened the show a couple of minutes ago. So Clinton Geoffrey is with us here this week. He was having some lag issues, so we put him in timeout, but it's good to have you back.
I think we all had issues because Spencer crashed everything too, so it wasn't just me. It's one of those things where everybody starts reaching. What? Like when Facebook went down for the morning and we all thought we didn't pay our cell phone bills. And I can only imagine what all the providers went through that morning. But no, Todd, always good to have you around. I mean, you've been around this sport a long time. What's the hot story with the Pinties, now the NASCAR Canada Series? And hey, let's start that bullshit right there.
Sure. All let's right. Let's jump into
bucks.
That.
20 so, bucks every time someone says it wrong all year, all right?
Is that the deal? Okay. So it's whether it's here or anywhere, if you don't call it by the correct name, if you don't call it the NASCAR Canada Series, you put I was gonna suggest that we do something like that. Could make it a charitable thing. We could have a pretty good get together, I think, every time somebody messes up for 20 bucks a throw. But maybe we can come up with some sort of idea. So I'm anxious to see. I'm waiting for series announcements. I know there's some coming. I know there's a lot speculated. I know Adam doesn't care about it until the Thursday before the first race. Is that when you get involved? Or
now, wait a second. That was vengeful. That was a dagger. You just, it's not that I don't care.
I'm just reciting back what you've said.
I don't take anything verbatim until race weekend. Now, if Todd Lewis sends out a press release, I'll believe it. Like if someone hires Todd to write a release, I'll take that. If I'm talking rumor mill, if we're talking gossip, no, I really do wait for that weekend. I'll do a bit of homework, but that's sort of my standing joke. Partly because I have a day job, so I can't make it to test day. I can't make it, so I just cook up a story on why I don't really pay any attention till the time comes. But if you listen to everything, if you listen to the rumor mill, Todd, J.R. Fitzpatrick could be a full-time sprint car racer on dirt this year. So would Rick Spencer, Walt. There's so many things that happen. You just kind of, I need it to fester, boil over, and then what's left after it all boils is who shows up at CTNP.
I'm with you in terms of the BS and nonsense, because someone will hear something, and whether it's accurate or not, everybody seems to add their own little personal touch or spin or additional speculation and information. And by the time the second or third person has heard it, you're right. It's J.R. Fitzpatrick is a full-time Sprint Cup driver. And, Alex Tagliani is going to race Formula One and things like that happen. So it's the nonsense and people only hearing half of what's said and then deciding to interpret and, quite frankly, making stuff up, which I'm with you, Adam. It's just, put the BS aside. If you want to discuss a story, then I'm good with that. But no, I don't like that.
But I liked you coming in hot. I enjoyed that. I want more of that.
You got it. All right. Where do you want it? You want more? You want more NASCAR Canada hot or something else? You tell me.
No, just more taking shots at me. Take some at Clint too. Just anyone. Shoot some at Spencer as well. No holds barred. Just come in. Guns a blazing.
Yeah, that's my style. So
I got a couple follows up here. So first off, $20 throwdown. I throw the first $20 because I screwed it up, and I'll take the lead on that. So Mike Kura is saying, the cheating way of saying it would be NASCAR Canada Series, because it's truly the NASCAR Canada Series Pinty's and Enviro. So, but I think for the bet's sake, we are all going to know it as the NASCAR Canada Series. That's been the short form we've all kind of adopted already. Yes. When we're talking about it as a crew. So this is a 24-hour, I catch you saying it at the airport at 6 in the morning from across the table. That's $20, Lewis. All right. So if anybody drops CASCAR, NASCAR, Pinty's Series, anything that isn't NASCAR Canada. Unless I look you in the face and say, I'm gonna say it out of turn now, but it ain't gonna cost me $20, and we can have a laugh about it. So
let's go around the horn. I'm gonna go last. Todd, you're gonna go first. Who are the two sponsors of NASCAR Canada?
It would be the two presenting sponsors of NASCAR Canada, Pinty's and Everum.
Oh, Todd did it. So I have not heard. I call it Enviro. Clint, I think you, and Todd, am I mistaken? Did you call it Enviro last year? Were we all on that train?
I am possibly, but I have found out and got it straight from the source. It's Enviro.
Right. And I didn't pick that up until we interviewed Trayton. And I'm thinking, Trayton, learn how to say your sponsor. Like, it didn't occur to me that we're all in the wrong. But yeah, that's what I was getting at. Everum. So that's going to be another thing. We got to say it all right.
Say it correctly if you're using it. I'm with you, Clinton.
Pronunciation snob. Like, you bust my balls for Motorama, Motorama. Big effing deal. You know what I mean?
Hey, these guys pay the bill.
It's a French company, and we're translating it to English. But I got real business to talk about with Todd here, okay? So hold on. First off, the field, Todd. A lot is made about the field. You guys just kind of touched upon it. I don't feel we're worried about that. I think maybe it's because we're going to CTMP to kick off the season. That always has a great field of cars that no one's really having the worry some feeling about car counts. This series seems to always bounce back. You know, any feelings do you have? You ever felt that way, that, you know, it's in trouble?
There's, you're right, over the life of the series, now the NASCAR Canada series, we have at times thought, oh, this might be a tough year. And there are times that it's been a bit of a struggle, but I think we'll be okay. Are we going to have as big a field at every event as we did in 23? Maybe not. But one or two cars down at one or two events, I don't think spells the end of the series by any stretch of the imagination. I think the future is very bright for the NASCAR Canada series. And you're always going to have the fluctuation of one or two more, one or two fewer from year to year. And it might be one or two fewer full-time competitors, but I think we'll still have excellent fields because we'll have part-time racers from Quebec, from the East Coast, and from out west running in events as well. So I don't think the fields are really going to suffer. The far-flung races from the center of the country, the East Coast and out west, those fields might be a little bit smaller, but I really don't see any sort of doom and gloom in that way.
Adam, before I turn over to you, I would also say that losing Trayton from the series, as much as we hate losing the talent, is going to bring some new blood to the series and some new winners, I think. So, you know, when you can look at it from that side too. Go, Adam.
Yeah, when someone leaves that won more than half the races the year before, sure, people are going to be chomping at the bit to take that over. I miss the old days when we used to go out west. We would get a big handful of Western drivers, the Haars, the Sieverts, the, you know, Jason White for a time when he wasn't following the whole series, same as when we went east. We haven't had as much of that in the last couple of years that I've really seen. There's
right.
been a
Nick
couple.
Nick Jewell, Jamie Krizik, Matthew Shirley has been out. But you're right. That's unfortunate. I hope that we still get a few from out west. I know that some drivers have been talking, some are, and so hopefully things come together. But again, that it kind of goes in ebbs and flows, and hopefully we've had a little bit of down. So hopefully it's back on the upswing again. I think the series is pointed in the right direction to do that.
And to go a little inside baseball on it, part of the reason that the fans are wondering, it's very expensive to keep a NASCAR legal car updated year after year. There's a lot of expensive upgrades. So where it used to be, teams could keep a car for a few years, not have to spend a ton of money, just get it ready to go racing. Now there's a lot of upgrades. There's a lot of expense. So most of the people we do see, I shouldn't say most, but some of them are rent-a-rides, renting from the teams that are hauling out from the east. To wherever we're going. So, but I've never felt better. Maybe the only other year I felt this good about what was coming was the first year Pinty's took over as the main sponsor. There was a ton of positive energy that year. I feel that this year as well. I just feel, I think Gavin LaBrosse is going to be a game changer for this series. I'm very excited.
I agree with you. Yeah, I agree with you that he, and I know he has been very busy nonstop since, well, even before actually being officially announced as coming on and taking over. He's been meeting with a lot of people and a lot of teams and a lot of, not just drivers, but teams and team owners. And he's been working flat out to try to push the series forward, bring in more partners, bring in more teams. And, credit to Doug Gonder as well, who took over last year, first year in the role. Now he's had a year of it, and he's made some big steps as well and done an awful lot of good things for the series. So I agree with you. I think that's a great comparison, actually, that this is the point where the series is poised to take another step forward. It may not happen in the next two or three or four months or in mid-season, but I can see the progression going forward and the growth happening.
I agree on all those statements. You know, I had to work hand-in-hand with Doug Gonder in two challenging races at Oshweekin. We were both dealing with the weather coming in and then to scheduling to a whole nother day. It's no secret here that I'm friends with Tony Spiteri, as we all are, and Tony asked me when he first took up jobs, well, just tell me what you see, buddy. And I said, well, you guys couldn't pivot if you had to. You know what I mean? We have six meetings about something. That's the way it's going to be. Even if we're walking through a tornado, they're not changing that. And that was the thing that I saw from Doug. We were able to make changes on the fly. I'm in the infield at each week, and he's running the show, and we're making minute-to-minute updates to make sure we get the show in on the Monday. And I really felt that that series came a long way. Again, them and I have the same feeling about Al Nebras. Tagliani slowing down. There's some more notes I got for you. And the bilingualism was something I also want to discuss because I had that talk with Al Nebras too. Let's get into that first, and we'll maybe get to Tagliani in a minute. I'll give you a minute to think about my Tags questions. You know, with Tags slowing down, he's probably one of the best salesmen. Can we bring him in as a coach someday to get some of these other guys to show him how the money should be working here in Canada? We'll get back to that in a minute. Bilingualism. You know, I had that talk with Al Nebras. I said, Alan, leading into Moto Rama Rama, whatever Adam wants me to call it today. But I think, I said, we have a problem with here, okay? The series has been talked down to by the Ontario other outsiders as the French series now. Now we got a French guy running it. It's mostly run by French guys. And I said, that's a big problem here in Ontario, Alan. And in order, you really have to combat that. And for me, the concern I had was we had two French teams that week who put out great releases, I think, but I couldn't translate them. They had no English presence, and that kind of left me out of the deal. And I said, if you can grab those guys that are putting stuff out and say, hey, guys, I realize you're all French and everybody in the world's French, but we need the English guys to care about you guys, too. We need to care about, and I'm not picking on Cote, but the new guys who are coming in, we don't know their history. And I think that's one thing that we really have to push. And it's going to be on us guys as media of the series too, to help making sure that we're getting those messages out so it doesn't become a quote-unquote French series.
Yes, I agree with you that there are two official languages. And if you're going to communicate, it's best that if you're communicating in both of them, because you expose yourself to the widest possible audience. I get a little upset with people who said, it's becoming the French series now. Well, no, that's not the case, because Alan has just taken over. And yes, he is French Canadian. But prior to that, there were no French Canadian officials as part of NASCAR Canada. So honestly, I would suggest that the French and Quebec contingent was underrepresented for good portions of the history going back over NASCAR in Canada. So I think having more and better French representation and representation from Quebec is a positive. It is a good thing. And to have it in both languages is essential. You're right. If you're a Quebec team and you only put out an announcement in French, well, you're limiting yourself. You're right. Your sponsor might be from Quebec and their first language and only language may be en français. However, you want to expose yourself to the widest possible audience, and the series wants to promote you and promote you to the widest possible audience. So let's use both languages.
So I'm going to say something. A lot of our fans, again, they haven't been down to Quebec, but, and Todd, you might not even know this because you were always busy working, but when we would go to show, before there was live streaming, when we would go to Chaudière, we would go to St. Eustache, we would go to ICAR, those races would be presented in Franglish. I would speak English, a French announcer would speak French, and we would work together. And we wouldn't translate each other. We would bounce back and forth between French and English. So fans in Quebec, and they freaking loved it because it was high energy, but they would get English and French in the same broadcast back and forth, and they were able to figure it out. And we loved it as announcers. It was exciting. Imagine it was bringing super that fun to Ontario.
Yeah, it was.
It would not fly.
No, well, you're but again, you know, cater to your audience. The if in Quebec, the audience is predominantly French speaking when you go to Autodrome Chaudière or some of the other tracks. So again, present it with French first. But when you go to the larger event at GP3R, there is French and English presented. Drivers introduced in both French and English. They say, you know, they give the command to fire engines in both French and English. So you are presenting to a wider audience. And I think we need to see more of that.
And so, Clint, to your point, if I'm from Quebec, I'm saying, F you. We do that. We already accommodate. We leave Quebec. There's no accommodation for them. Right? Yeah, I don't talk with a French.
And Reads and Media says the same way. Do we think the English team should adapt it for French? If you're in this series, absolutely. Or like Todd said, you're missing the opportunities. You're doing your sponsors a disservice. You know, it's a national series. You have to serve everybody.
100%.
Ultimately, you serve the people who pay your bills. So, and Todd, you write a press release. Say you write a press release for DJ Kennington. You only mention one oil company. There's only one oil company that matters when you're running for DJ Kennington.
Yes, but your team, your team, whether you are based in Quebec or whether you are based in Ontario, you are part of a national series. So why would you not want to draw from as large a population as possible? Draw from, you know, it doesn't matter if your sponsor is based in Quebec, if you have English fans as part of your cheering section at any of the events. I don't think so. It's more attention on their product or service. I think you want to expose yourself to as wide an audience as possible.
But it's whatever the bill payers want. And I'm not, I don't know who would not want to be in both languages, but there are people like, I don't give a shit what happens in Quebec. My business is in Western Canada, you know, if they're in the oil sands business, but I get just devil's advocate.
If you're devil's asshole, that's what you are every week. Always trying to pick the shitty side. Back to that, you know, when you look at the series, if with a business mind, if you're in that deal, a lot of the fan base is in Quebec. So, you know, yeah, your bill payers may be here in Ontario, but heck, if I can get the whole thing is bringing new people to my sponsor. And if that's the second language does it, then let's do it.
And that's the thing with the series too, is that's why, you know, the series needs to present in both French and English, is you need to bring in a more audience. That's what every racing series is in need of: more eyeballs, more people at the tracks, more people watching live streams, more people watching on television. And, you know, criticizing a series for trying something new, doing something different. That's, you know, the objective is to bring more people in. So instead of trying to say, well, why do you do it that way? That's not the way I like it. It's not the way it's always been done. And I've been a supporter. We're trying to bring more people in. How about you open up your arms too and say, yeah, this is what my series is. This is what I've come to enjoy. Let me expose you to it. Let me help you understand it, as opposed to the, well, I don't like it because it's new. I find that so exasperating.
Tagliani, you know, he's slowing down here a bit, Todd. You know, what a salesman he is. And I think it was probably on the Gary Klute podcast I might have seen, where he was talking a bit about the business here in Canada and talking like, you know, if he was saying, if I can't make it work, how are these other guys going to make it work? You know, is there a future for Tags after retirement as a marketing coach?
There should be. And if I've had a lot of great conversations with Alex over the years about racing and motorsports and the business and karting and how much money gets spent and where you spend it. One of the last ones was, I think it was last year at CTMP at one of the race. We were walking in opposite directions, and I stopped and I said, "Hey, how are you?" And 20 minutes later, I left, because that's how long the conversation was. And that's the passion that he has. That's the enthusiasm he has for racing and motorsports and the business. He has a lot of really good ideas about how to bring it in. I'm not sure he's ready to step away completely for a while. I know he's sharing the 80 car with Donald Teige as it stands right now. I don't think he'd be opposed to doing a few other events either if the opportunity were to present itself, but I don't think he's ready to step away and give it up quite yet. But and I don't think he ever will, whether it's he may not drive forever, but I think that we'll still see him involved in the business and he should be, because he's great at working with clients and partners in terms of bringing them in and giving them return on investment. That's the other part that he delivers. Whatever he says that I'm going to give you, he gives you plus.
I hope he stays involved in the business of racing in a capacity where he can really have an effect, not just as a broadcaster like us, but actually as someone who can influence. He's just, as you've both said, he's so passionate. He is so intelligent. And he is a celebrity. He is the biggest celebrity we have up here. As name recognition, he carries himself, he plays the part. So yeah, whatever he's able to do, however he is able to stay involved, is going to be better for all of us involved in the sport.
Wouldn't it be great if you, whether he's racing or not, if he was at every race this year? That helps the series. That helps his team and his partners as well.
For sure. There's still hope. Todd, we appreciate your comments and always hanging out with us. It's a pleasure to work with you all summer long on the NASCAR Canada series.
Hey, good.
I'm working on that. We're going to have to bite our tongues. No, I'm sure we'll have you on before the season starts. Season kicks off May 19th. At CTMP. Repeat winner or new winner? Last question, quickly.
I think we'll have a repeat winner at the season opener.
All right, Adam.
So
there you have it. I don't remember who won last year, so it's going to be a new winner for me because I don't remember who won the last one.
Thanks, guys. Always good to talk to you. Look forward to seeing you many weekends over the summer, too. We'll talk soon.
Yeah, appreciate thanks, it, Todd.
Thank you. Always a great time. I can tell you one last year. I want to say that LaCroix pushed somebody out of the way at one of the CTMP races.
How many times have you been driving home from a race and you can't remember any of the feature winners from that race that you're driving home from?
I live with my dad, right? So he'll say, who won? And I'm like, Dad, I saw 70 features this weekend. You have to ask a better question. Like, who won
it's
a specific
so
race on a specific day? I might be able to whittle that back for you, but I don't know. I saw the conversation going on the APC series in the comments. Of course, we love the APC series too. We'll feature them next week as part of the show. We got some great stuff coming up with them. We're super excited to be the presenting sponsor on Racing America. We're also bringing it to Rev with us weekly, so super cool. Awesome to have two great thriving late model series here.
I reached out to Joe Lawrence this afternoon, but man, he's big leaguing me. You know what? He probably got back to me by now because he knew it would be too late to come on. Let's see. Yeah, he did. Sorry, Adam. Just seen this now. He's spending time with his daughter. So that's more important.
I was just going to throw a dart, Adam, but we'll hold off. That's a good duck and cover move. Like, don't read the message till we're already on the air. Be like, I just saw it now. Sorry.
Hey, it's all good. It's all good. He's such a nice guy. You can't get upset with Joe. He said, you know, most of our drivers are pretty freaking awesome. But yeah, our next guest is going to be exciting. I want to know what he's up to this year because I've heard all sorts of different things. But D-Dub, Dylan Westbrook, what is going on?
Not too much. How are you guys?
Good, buddy.
All right,
I love Robbie Longo. Where's Dylan? Let's talk dirt. Like, enough about the pavement stuff. Let's go. D-Dubs, first off, that is the question. Where are you going to be racing this year? Not that we've heard any big issues or nothing. Just you lay low as always. You're probably one of the most low-riding dudes we know. So, you know, one of the best competitors we've had in the history of Oshweekin Speedway and 360s here in Ontario. What are the plans for 2024, big guy?
Pretty much same as last year. Do Oshweekin and SOS, and then maybe hopefully this year hit a couple of the big races down the States if it just kind of works out and fits into the schedule. But yeah, pretty much same as last year, but hopefully hit a couple in the U.S. if it works out.
Dylan, how do you get to this point? You've got a successful business. From what I hear, you're staying real busy, but you were a meteor. You were rising to the top of this sport. You're still a hell of a competitor. How do you settle into this new role? Are you happier doing this, picking and choosing, or would you be happier out on the road running 70 races a year?
It's kind of both ways. Like, it was a lot of fun out on the road. Like, it was awesome to move up to the top level and go race with those guys. But, we kind of did that the worst time too when COVID was going on. So we were gone for like months on end. Like, I think, I don't even know how long we were gone. It felt like forever. So it's a lot of fun, but I don't know. I like being around home too. So then when kind of got the opportunity to race around home and still be home, but race too. It kind of works out good, man, with the shop now. Just really busy doing that. So it worked out really good. Racing still at home, still get to be at home a lot more, and yeah, kind of a happy medium.
Good.
Dylan, a lot of talk at gets made about Shweikin surface. You know, you've seen it kind of change a bit. There's a lot of people saying they want it, the old Shweikin back. We need a cushion. We need it. You know, to me, that worries me because, you know, I've seen it go when it's not at its best, it's freaking terrible, right? And we're tearing cars up. So to me, at least when we're smooth and slick, I know we're not ripping cars up. But man, I'm not opposed to it. I don't think Glenn is, but you know, how do we get back there? Well, what are we missing there, if anything, in your eyes?
I mean, like Oshwegan's worst is like every other's like average track in the States. It feels like when we were on the road, like a worst night for Oshwegan, like that's like a just your average night on like a bunch of these tracks in the States. Like you're always gonna have some holes or ruts here and there. So, I mean, it's not really that bad when people say it gets that bad, but I don't know, like I like it both. Like you get a bit of everything out of Oshwegan. Like when we were out on the road, you don't really get like that super, super slick that often. So like it, I did a lot, like I got really good at like kind of the tackier tracks, it seemed like. And at the end of last year, it kind of seemed like we finally started to get something figured out on the slick track. But I don't know, I like both. Like now I kind of like perfect ideal situation be like if there's a top and a bottom, so you can actually like have two lines, where sometimes when it gets real slick like that, it seems like it's just kind of around the middle. But yeah, I like them all, just got to figure out how to get fast on them.
Well, that's the name of the game, do it a little bit better than everybody else and keep on chasing that. What do you need to do this year, Dylan, to chase that championship again?
We've changed a couple things, just, and then at the end of the last season, like I said, we were definitely starting to get some stuff figured out, so go a little bit further than what we did then, and yeah, I think we'll finally be right back to where we were. I mean, when it was had some grip in the track, we were definitely still good then, but yeah, just struggled a little bit when the super, super slick this year, or last year.
Dylan, you got any races coming up before the Oshweekend start? Will you guys venture out preseason at all?
Well, we're gonna do
Merrittville coming up, right?
Yeah. But,
I mean, yeah. Outside the general realm, we got Merrittville April 20th, and then after that, there's nothing till the season starts. So, anything beyond that?
We were kind of looking last week, kind of looking at stuff and seeing if we could hit a couple of them. So, I think we will try at least hit one of them before Oshweekend starts, but it's not 100%, but definitely like to. Just normally I'm down in Florida racing by now, so it probably wouldn't be a bad idea to get in the car once before the season actually starts.
Do you think that will have an effect, Dylan? Like how long does it take you normally to shake the rust off?
Probably like one hot lap session. Like when you first go into the corner, it's like, oh, I haven't done this in a while, we're going fast. And then after a couple laps, kind of figure out, and it's just like riding a bike and don't really forget it.
You know, Dylan, how do you feel about Merrittville? Is it a place you like? Is it a place you're comfortable? That it's a place I grew up, so I know it's a tricky D-shaped track. And, you know, what's your thoughts on that?
I like it. Like, yeah, it seems like it's always pretty racy there. So, and like, I always had some decent luck there too. And yeah, just, I like the shape of it. Makes it pretty interesting. And there's always top, bottom, it seems like. And yeah, always had some pretty good luck there. Got my first DSS win there, so definitely like the place.
So, Dylan, what will make you happy in 2024?
I mean, definitely like to win the SOS series again, be a repeat of that, and hopefully I'd like to win the Oshwegan one again too, just to kind of, yeah, get a couple wins and kind of go from there. Just, oh, go out there, have fun too, and do the best we can, have a bunch of wins, hopefully, and hopefully get a championship.
Fan question, Dylan, you know, where do you sit with the Brighton races? You know, you're tight with the Turfords there. They run the SOS. There was a split last year. Do you go to Brighton this year?
Yeah, I think I kind of forgot about that. Yeah, we're going to plan on doing the Brighton races too. It's yeah, it seems like they have a good like little series put together there, and I like Brighton too. With really good track, so hopefully you hit all those also.
What is your favorite racetrack, Dylan? You've seen a bunch of them, or even a favorite event.
Yeah, that's like definitely just because always like grew up like always racing there off Oswegan, but like even was it Lucas Oil Speedway in Missouri, that's pretty cool. It's kind of like Oswegan a little bit, but you have a wall on one end. That's a cool track. Yeah, or Lake Ozark. I have really good luck there, but it's like a bit smaller than Oswegan, wall on each end. Makes it pretty cool because really other than Southern Ontario or South Buxton now, if it's changed already, other than that place, there's nowhere in Canada with a wall like all the way around it.
How do you like Buxton?
I like it. Like it's, I think it's like going to be really good. Hopefully they get a bunch of cars out there and I think it will put on a really good race. Yeah, with the wall all the way around, like if it does build up a bit of a curve, normally you can be right up on the wall. So be real exciting for the fans, and it's wide enough that the bottom is always going to be quick too.
Have you ever raced with anyone, Dylan, and thought, my God, they have bigger balls than I do? Because I've never seen anyone charge a track like, but has anyone ever caught your attention that, man, oh man, that's something else?
Oh yeah, like if I'm just watching a race and like a heat race or something and see them go by, I'm like, dude, am I doing that too? Like, that looks crazy. Like when you're in the car, I don't know, it doesn't feel that like fast or that close to the wall. But when you're watching, it's like, oh, that, there's no way I'm doing that too.
That's Dylan, awesome. Have you been racing long enough that you feel, man, you know, that one hurt because I'm getting old? Do you feel the age yet? Have you ever gotten out of a car and thought, man, if I was 18, I wouldn't be feeling that no more?
No, not yet. I mean, hopefully don't have any wrecks this year, so we don't have to figure that out. But I haven't really had a real bad one lately, knock on wood. Hopefully it stays like that.
Yeah, for sure.
Hey, let's promote your business, Dylan. If people are out in your area, how can they support you?
If you need anything fixed, stop in, give me a call. Do like everything, like all your automotive and trucks, diesels, dirt bikes, quads, farm equipment, like pretty much if it has a motor or needs fixing, we can do it.
What's the name of the place?
DWR Automotive.
What city?
Scotland, Ontario.
All right. We appreciate you joining us, Dylan. We've following you all year, as always.
Yeah. Thank you. We'll thanks for having touch. Me on.
Thanks, Dylan. Yeah,
thanks.
Bye.
Well, Stars of Oswegan, the SOS, and everything sprint car related here in Ontario. Dylan Westbrook, good to have him with us.
I don't know how to say this and not be rude or not, like, I don't mean it this way, but that's the first time I've talked to Dylan Westbrook, and I thought, he looks like a grown-up. Like, he's always just been he always looks like a kid to me. Even with a beard, he's always looked like a kid. And I noticed as he was standing, man, Dylan Westbrook grew up.
Tap to us. Think how many kids we've seen grow up in our 25 plus years at the Speedway. All right. We got some cool stuff to chat through now. We're going to have some fun. Thanks to Todd and Dylan for dropping by. We got a bunch of Burger Barn videos of the week. We're going to preview next week's show as well. All right. Let's jump right into it. Burger Barn videos of the week. What do we got, Spencer? Leave our mics up so we can talk over them. Turn up the sound so we can hear them. Let's go. Oh. Okay, so I learned this my first year racing with Bobby Davidson and Barry Davidson. They had a paving company, but they had steamrollers. And you throw some cardboard on the ground, and you throw your front up doors on there, and you drive. This is good racing handymanism right here, bud.
Wonder how many tires they go through.
Nah, tires. It's just tin. But man, nothing straightens out a door better than driving back over it with another car. So, you know, that's one cool thing. I've actually seen that done. It works good. And hopefully you only have to do that once or twice a year. Next one, Spencer, what do we got?
Down goes the 18 wagon.
Oh, this is awesome. Christian. This is one of those Red Bull things.
Yeah. And it's the one jump nobody can get over, right?
Spencer, can we start it over? Stop. Start it over. Okay, so hold it right there. Okay, so first off, these dudes, you get style points. You got to make it to the end of the run. You got to have two. I think we got to build one of these. But look at these guys. So for our generation, they start off as the 18 van. Okay, it's really quick. It goes by. hit it. Come out of the gates as the 18 van. Go up, Spencer. Roll it.
Christian.
Boom. That pulls off. Now they're the General Lee. Okay, let it run.
All of a sudden, it becomes the General Lee for the Dukes of Hazzard. So that's going to impress the judges. It's all about style and showmanship.
Look at that crowd.
Speed. And this looks pretty quick, doesn't it? With the B.A. Baracus Mohican, obviously for the 18.
He's got a mouth guard.
The DeLorean from back to the
oh!
And it's flying down the circuit too. Around the island it goes. Richie at the front.
Awesome.
The back. It looks a good ride this over the bone rattler. Didn't rattle anybody's bones that because it flew over there. All they've got to go is the factory. And it's absolutely flying down the circuit. This looks as quick as anything we've seen today. Safely over there. Never moved a muscle. And easily over the finish line. It was quick. It was effective. And we saw three vehicles in one on the way down. The 18 van to start with, then the General Lee, and they crossed the line.
Now, the videos that I saw with that, there was one jump that none of them survived. Like, they kept blowing up.
That's why I watched that one, because I saw the same thing. It's pretty rare they can actually finish a run, but those guys had it set up, and the style points were perfect for us, for our generation. What do we got next, Spencer? Oh, this is an old sprint car trick. So this is an old sprint car, dude, Pennsylvania, I believe it is. Their electric heater that warms the oil on a sprint car.
What are you gonna do with it?
Heat up the wheel bearing.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, our heater quit.
Is it electrical?
The backup.
Is it electrical?
Maybe. I don't know.
If I get time, you want me to look at it for you?
Well, it's a battery.
Something. Oh, it's a battery. Okay.
So this is old school backup. That's what we used to do years ago before we had those heaters.
This was the way.
Well, that's the way I did it.
Just got to let it burn down a little before you slide her under, huh?
Yeah.
But at least it's not terrible cold out today.
So what they're doing there is that tray of charcoal. Our modern guys now, when they have the blanket over, you can see it to keep the engine oil hot. Biggest problem we got with sprint cars, unlike other race cars, is getting them hot and warm enough to race. So they're using barbecue charcoal. Once the flames start, he's going to put that under the race car like a barbecue. It's going to heat up the oil in the oil tank in the engine block and bring heat to the motor using a charcoal fire. I thought it was neat. Old school.
Yeah,
that's
doing sure.
Back in the 50s. Do we got anything else, Spencer? Oh, okay. This brings me back to... Okay, they're playing Lee Greenwood. But
how long is Lee Greenwood going to live off this?
But come on, RC, guys.
One more lap.
I do love Lee Greenwood. All right, cut it.
You know what that reminds me of? That song reminds me of Darien Lake. Because that song was always in their laser show at the end of every night.
Well, they'll play it at like football games and college games. Still here, though. Hold me up. Hold on. RC, guys, give me a break. You know, did you say a prayer before you had your four wide in the basement? Like, come on. I'm sorry. That's pushing it too much. It's a little too much. But, hey, we are going to look at some cool slot cars, so to each their own.
I love watching the shit. I love watching the shit that gets you angry.
Oh, piss me right off. And, like, anyways. Okay, preview of next week's show. Show the Skip Barber one first, Spencer. So I talked to Kevin Ridley. Skip Barber bought SRX. Kevin Ridley was our inside contact that we know from the Northeast Sportsman deal. I reached out to Kevin Day, said, hey, man, did you get hired? Can you talk? He said, I should be able to come on your show next week and discuss SRX and what the plan is. Skip Barber, they were the ones that kind of towed them all around, managed the car fleet along with Kevin and that. And so hopefully I have some news on that. I spoke to Ken Schrader a bit about it. He was talking that they need a bit of a different bit. It can't be $250,000 US for the tracks. We can't afford it. 100 grand, we'll pay it. 250, you're probably going to be bankrupt again. So hopefully that works, and we can get Kevin on and talk about that. The other guest we tried to get tonight was Mike Lichty. This is him trying to set the short track record at Bristol. Run this, Spencer.
But the guy to beat is this Mike. It is
super modified
to beat his own record,
and I think he's going for it. When he left pit road, I saw four brand new sticker Hoosier tires
listen
in his car.
So when you
listen
to
the RPMs,
to a stock car going around this racetrack, we are going a lot faster, a couple seconds, and maybe 20 to 30 miles per hour faster.
Well, it's about a second and a half, JR. The track record for a Sprint Cup Series car here, the track record, Ryan Newman back in March of 2003, 14.90 over 128 miles an hour.
So right now, as we look at Mike Lichty and his number 74, a new record at 143.98.
Jason Blonde said we're going to get into 13-2s, and we keep getting closer and closer to it.
We only have a couple of minutes left here, and Jason Blonde, that crew, did a great job to get back out on the racetrack, but Mike Lichty is faster still.
There it is, 13.26, over 144 miles an hour, average around a half-mile racetrack.
But the
And I don't think he kept that record. I don't think he set that record, did he? I think an upright sprint car beat it.
So I've looked at all these things. I've been looking all night. Well, not all night, but for a bit before. I see Sam Haferteep did a lap of 142. That was a 13.326. They just said he was a 13.267. But, man, still, that's lightning quick around that place.
I thought
the NASCAR. Go ahead.
I thought it was Jason Blonde that said it. And the other thing I remember, when they did set the fastest lap, they weren't running the bottom of the track. I seem to recall Johnny Benson, a bunch of them were talking. They ran the middle groove, keep the RPMs up, keep the speed up a little. But I loved that. An event like that, to me, is just so cool.
So it was open time trial to see who could go the fastest on a short course half-mile racetrack, right? So.
Yep.
As I was looking down the list, Stuart Friesen actually holds two of the late model speed records. Late models on pavement in the Bristol Throwdown in 2021. He had the fastest time, and he also has the fastest time on dirt. Kyle Larson has the fastest time in a cup car on dirt, and also the fastest time in a cup car at Bristol. So we'll talk to Mike Lichty about that experience next week, and we'll also hopefully have Kevin Ridley on. Where are we going now, Spencer? I think we're going to Toys of All Sizes. This is Adam's part two of last week's slot car set. Adam, tell us the story behind this. Who sent you this, and what is this all about?
Boy, put me on the spot. Strading, P. Strading. Is it Paul or is it Pete? Oh, my God, that's embarrassing. Strading is the last name. I met him at Jim Sweer's shop a couple of weeks ago. And he was showing off some pictures of his slot car tracks. You got to send me these so we can show them off. Because what he wants to do, Spencer, don't do this to me. This is the same shit we showed last year. No more pit tours. We want racetrack. There we go. So as we get towards the racetrack, see a little bit more of the detail. And he's got a bunch of, I know he's going to put stickers and scuffs around the outside. He's going to put GeForce TV. He's got various different logos that he wants to throw out on this thing. But what a great job. Like right down to the lighting, all the detail on this track. Very, very cool. There's the broadcast crew. I think that's Benny Parsons and Ken Squire, wasn't it? Go back to that last one. What would you say, Clint? Maybe we lost Clint. All right, well, carry on, Spencer. But pretty cool, the detail that goes into this.
I'm here. That was definitely Ken Squire.
And BP on the other side.
That is super cool.
Yeah, yeah. Yep. Brian Gerster, 12.742.
I thought it's cool. You know, my dad's a big slot car guy. We had slot cars. I think I probably still have some stuff around the house here somewhere. I know Brian Halliwell, who runs our turn three spot at Oshweken. They have a Rockcliffe Speedway. They race slot cars on an oval there every week. Super cool. Buxton, Southern Ontario Motor Speedway updates. They had their rules meeting on Sunday, Adam. I felt bad. I watched a bit of someone's video. Craig March is up there. rookie to the deal. He was running the family business last week, and now he's running a speedway trying to deal with that crowd. I thought it was, tough deal, man. I can't imagine. I shit my pants going into mine. I've done them for 20 years. I can't imagine what they must have felt on Sunday to get up there. But wish them all the best. They are going ODCC rules for mini stocks and thunder stocks. That has been confirmed. They've also joined the duel on the dirt. Going to pay the registration fee and have a combined race for both classes as well. It's looking like September 21st, along with other dates they've announced. We wish them the best as they look into that. So, hopefully they can work it out. Last topic we got, Adam, is Airborne Speedway decide they're going to go on Thursdays. That's a bold move, Cotton, as you would say. Thoughts on that? And the thought process is there's a lot of, there's a lot of other racetrack pressure on Fridays in their area, so they're going to try Thursdays. Man, to me, that's like a Sunday. It's a school night. You're going to be home late. It's just, it scares me. Your thoughts?
If you draw the right people. I know Mike Mahaney said he's going to be running Airborne every week, I believe. But imagine, what if you could get Matt Shepard?
Yeah.
Right? Would you run Thursday instead of Friday if you could lock down Shepard being there every week? It might just be brilliant.
Yeah, I mean, there's lots of like Thursday isn't a terrible day, but just to me getting out early. But you bring up a good point. If you can run a good, that's when you got to be on point more than ever. You got to really knock it out of the park and be on your game there.
And they point that out in the press release, right? It's going to be a tight show. Get people out of there by 10 o'clock. Put on an entertaining night of racing. And you put that pressure on yourself that you've got to hit those marks. I think there should be Saturday tracks that do the same thing. Hey, we're going to try to get you out of here at 10 o'clock. We're going to run a tight show. I know that there are, but actually put that in print. Say, here's what we want to do. Here's what we want to achieve, and it's going to be good.
I got to tell you, us going to our qualifiers were amazing last year. Like, I love those races. And there was nothing that I was happier or more proud about. Like, Don Spee showed up there the one night, and I knew he was in the house. And we led up with our qualifier number one for the Thunderstocks. And 19 cars rolled out for that first qualifying race of the night to kick off our program. And I was like, yeah, baby, we're going racing right off the bat. And it was awesome. Yeah. Like, I think, getting away from 6-7 car heats has been the best thing we've ever done at Oshawegan in our stock classes.
Yeah. It was, and really, you give every driver out there someone to play with.
Yeah.
Right? Because we always talk about Dave Bailey and Ryan Beagle charging to the front and Kyle Wirt. There's a bunch of other drivers who might be running for sixth place in that 7-car heat and just be out there running in circles. Put 19 cars on the track, they're going to be able to learn more. They're going to have people to play with. They're going to be able to up their game that much faster.
Two things. Want to send a shout out to Kirk Hooker. Kirk,
yes.
You're feeling better.
So
battling away there, and we really appreciate you, man.
Yeah, Kirk is battling cancer. I've had the chance to talk to him a couple of times. What a beacon of light that man is. He's been around a long time running both asphalt late models and dirt late models. He's got a real long surgery coming up, then a bunch of chemotherapy to try to beat this cancer, and we're all pulling for you, man.
Yeah, he always ends our conversation with a compliment. I appreciate his calls when we get them. And, on a more somber note, I got to send a shout out to Tina Stiers. Her mom passed away last night, Pat. And all the best to Tina and the family. Man. And, Pat was sick for a bit, so Tina's been dealing with that. So hugs to all our Oshawegan family as they deal with that. And, we need everybody here. We're coming into racing season. Racing family, we got to get back together. It's going to be great. I'm more pumped than ever as we get closer to it. It's like a freight train coming at me, but we'll be ready to go. Saw Glenn today, for 5 minutes. He's a beacon energy. How can you not be pumped up to go racing, spending 2 minutes around Glenn? He was on his new pull-down rig, which we'll probably show off next week a little bit. Should have some more video about that. And just fun all around, man. We got some exciting video shoots coming up.
Who did he hire to operate the pull down rig? Who knows how to use it?
They were loading the car onto it. I didn't get in that. I didn't get that deep into it. But yeah, we're trying to get Robbie's golf carts fixed and everything we need to get going. But we're ready to go. Oh, I met with Rick Scott last week. Talked about another pace truck. So everybody's good for the most part.
And I think we're a week to 2 weeks away from announcing a new partner for this show, Clinton. I don't even know that I've really told you about it, but we're like a week or two away from something good. Yeah, it's always fun to bring on somebody new, and I think we'll be able to make a difference for them.
Awesome. We appreciate you all hanging out with us here weekly. I want to say Tuesdays, but as soon as I say that, Spencer's going to move it to Wednesday next week or something. But we try to be here Tuesdays.
You know what?
As do you guys.
Next week, I've got an event Tuesday night, so we've either got to move or you need to hire Todd Lewis for a
See,
week.
See, you are the devil's asshole.
I'm just the asshole.
Oh, hang on. I know what you did last weekend, Adam, and you didn't tell us. Spencer, where's those pictures? So the first one. The second one I sent you would be the first one. Come on, don't you know the second one's the first one? The one where Adam is, yeah, that one. So, Adam went out. You did some exercise in Santa Claus pants on the weekend? I got spies everywhere,
I
bro.
I did.
I got spies everywhere.
I did.
People send me stuff.
But listen, I'm not proud of this, okay? I tried to register for the race last week, but registration was closed. I crashed the Round the Bay 5K race.
That's
so
right.
I ran it with Dave. Dave Hunzinger was legit. He paid his way. I did not. Dude, the picture from the finish line, I'm about to die.
Hold on. Spencer, can you zoom in on that last picture? Connor's not going to like it, but zoom in on the face. Man, you look so much like Connor there from afar. Sorry, Connor, but
really?
You look a lot like your dad. Okay, go to the next picture now. We all have that curse.
Oh, my God, I just see.
Look at this. So Twitch, it sends me this. He goes, it's the final thrust to the ice cream truck. Look at you guys go.
Oh,
that's how we're
going
to end the show. Dave looks like he's laughing and you laughing at you ready to die.
Listen, Dave waited for me at the end, but I beat him to the halfway point. I'm looking for him from people that came around the corner to come back. Where the hell is he? And then I get to the corner and realize I was ahead of him. I'm like, holy shit, how did that happen? He beat me.
I'm proud of you guys. I'll get my steps in this summer, but I'm not going out there in the freezing cold to walk around the bay.
It was all good. It was all good. Good show, man.
Thanks, Spencer, for everything you do for us. Busy summer ahead. We can't wait for it. Thanks to all you folks for hanging out with us. We're excited to get back to it. Last one there pays the ice cream, and we're out.